And I now take the opportunity. Already, Rajul, we introduced you before you came in the inauguration, and his CV is a long one. And only thing I want to tell today is he's a student of Dr. Mullayan, I can say so. And he is one of the best researchers we have, and in ophthalmology and generally, I think you can even write to him for anything. And he's going to speak on study designs, which also will probably give some inputs to Dr. Nitin.
Good afternoon.
He had a question that he's constantly getting patients nagging him after excellent cataract surgery. That it's pretty.
I think clear corneal and there are some publications, if I'm not mistaken. No,
Dr. Nitin? But he wants to do a study. During clear your corneal talk, you can cover something so that it will help him.
Before I start, we'll get back to the question, Dr. Malkan's questions at the end. Before I start, whatever I'm going to speak is what I learned when I was doing residency under Dr. Avi Thomas and Professor Mullayan. My knowledge is inadequate when the person who has taught me sitting here. So I may make mistakes, and that's why I'll ask Professor Mullayan to correct me at the end of my talk. Basically, I'll try to cover in next 20-25 minutes basics of the different study designs. We can't cover all the study designs in great detail in 30 minutes. Some of the study designs Dr. Mullayan is going to cover in more detail, I think, tomorrow. And whatever we can do, and if you have any specific query, I'll be more than happy to answer that. So basically, the objective is to cover the different study designs in the next 25 minutes, to know the hierarchy of study designs and the strength and weakness of each study design, because there is nothing like perfect study design. It has to depend upon the study questions we have in the mind. So if you go hierarchy wise, then randomized control trial comes at the apex of the study designs. The meta-analysis of RCT comes at the most pinnacle of the triangle, then RCT, then we have a cross-sectional case control cohort studies, and at the end, case reports and case series and all that.
Rajul, she had a question on RCT. I don't know whether you listened to that. Doctor, what is the question? So that probably you didn't listen to the question. He's talking about RCT. Microphone.
Pardon? Yeah, can I'll repeat the question. No. But if the RCT is basically you have to read the article, but if there is a meta-analysis, that's what Dr. Gopal was saying, then they take the specific criteria for the question and then they would filter out. So, but again, it depends upon what I want. So if my question, specific question, and then I will see the what are the studies are done, and then I will take. But if you are saying that whether the RCT is done proper or not quality, that is very difficult. Basically, at the end of the day, you have to read each article yourself and then find out whether methodology is appropriate or not. We'll just sort it out. Professor Mullayan, will be...
Usually when I publish a paper, they are good papers.
So, you have to read the methodology. And tomorrow when we discuss about how to read the paper, we'll try to cover that what are the points we have to see each in paper. But eventually, because even the reviewers can make mistake, editor can make mistake, there are some very average paper get published in very good journals and vice versa, good papers get rejected. So even at the end of the day, when you want to get the from the paper from your day-to-day practice, you have to see whether this methodology is appropriate or not. And there are some of the points I'll be tomorrow mentioning, which I have learned from Professor Mullayan, from specific articles. So RCT, RCT, we say that is the best, you know, for the evidence. Does it mean that we can do for every questions? The simple answer is no. And I'll just give one question. Is it possible to do RCT on the effectiveness of parachute? jumping, you know, for the life saving? Will you be try to be in the control group? No. So each questions we cannot do RCT. It's just not possible. That doesn't mean that RCT is bad, but each questions would have a specific study designs, and we have to keep that in mind. Now I'll try to cover basically broadly all the study designs. So we have analytic study where we can do cross-sectional, case control, cohort. Cohort would have cohort and historical cohort and RCT. So we'll try to cover each study designs in isolation. So what is cross-sectional study design? That is correlation. So we just take certain number of people and see that what we are looking for. That out of 100, how many have diabetes, how many have glaucoma or whatever. It does not establish the causal relationship. So we can't say that if you found certain things, that out of 100 I had 10 glaucoma, out of that 8 were male and 2 were female, doesn't mean that all male is high risk of developing glaucoma from cross-sectional study. Though we can formulate the question based from our data, it cannot give a causal cause and effect relationship. Case control, basically we identify the group of cases with the disease, and we have a comparable group of subjects without disease. And then we determine the risk factor. So I have a 100 glaucoma patients, and I'll be talking mainly about glaucoma because I do glaucoma day in, day out. But basically 100 with the disease and 100 without the disease. But we doesn't mean that we just take randomly. We have to match it for the certain factors. And what we get at the end of the day, this is, I'm just giving outline. Cohort is basically, we take subject with the specific risk factor and we follow it up for years and years. So I can take patient with IOP more than 21, follow it up for 5, 10, 15 years and see how many develop glaucoma and what are the specific risk factor. So that is cohort. Then third is RCT. From then we go into type of study. Before that, I will just try to ask two questions. What do you mean by prevalence and what do you mean by incidence? What is the difference? The residents, people get confused about the prevalence and incidence. So before I talk about the case control study and cohort study, what, loudly, there is no need to mingle. What is prevalence? Friend, what is prevalence?
Microphone. Come on, somebody here can stand up and tell.
Use the simple language. The burden of disease in the to the population is very complicated. Simple language. So if I, at one point in time, I see 1,000 people, 30 has glaucoma. What does that mean? What is the prevalence? 30 over 100, or you want to simplify 3%? 3 in 100. Now what is incidence? Can we get incidence from this data? Then what we have to do? So we examine patient today. We go back to the same population after 1 year. Right? Now what is incidence? How we can get incidence? New cases in that 1 year period. That is incidence. So the prevalence and incidence is a different thing. Okay. That is what we have defined. The incidence is a new cases, prevalence is cases available at that point in time. So it's a cross-sectional study. Incidence data we cannot get from the cross-sectional. We have to go back to the population after a certain time, or we can go back for years and years, and we can average it out, and we can say that over a period of 5 years, if you get 5 new cases, then you can say 1 new case per year. Or if you have gone only once, then 1 case per year or whatever. It's always better to go for more time to get more precise data. So point prevalence is like Chennai glaucoma study, Andhra Pradesh glaucoma, eye disease survey, Vellore eye disease survey, they all had point prevalence. So first time we do, you go to people, then what is the point prevalence? Open angle glaucoma was 1.6%, angle closure was approximately 1%, angle closure glaucoma 0.9%, so I rounded up to 1%, angle closure suspect was 6.9, so 7%. So when I say 7%, that means we have gone one time. Out of 100 people, anything else you would like to know when we talk about prevalence? Which age group was evaluated? So if I have seen patient only about the age of 40 years, then this prevalence is above the age of 40 years. We cannot round it off and put it as a general population. Because younger people, we know that they would have a less risk of developing occludable angles. So risk of angle closure glaucoma would be much less in the younger age group. So if I say 7% in general population, it's a wrong figure. So when I say PACA 7%, you have to ask which age group were examined. So if I say 7 above the age of 40 years, then this 7% is for the above the age of 40 years. And when we round it off, when if I examine 0 to or 10 to 80 years, prevalence will go down. So depending upon which disease we are evaluating, prevalence will either go down, it will never increase. But prevalence would usually will go down when we take certain age groups and we try to generalize to the all population. Incidence. Yeah, we can. So, we can. I'm generalized. See, then specifically, then it would come to the what risk factor we are looking. So here I'm not talking about any risk factor. I'm just saying that I went in Mumbai, examined 1,000 people, and I got 10 people with glaucoma. So it's 1% glaucoma above the age of 40 years or above the age of 30 years for this population. Now race would come, then we try, then we see that which are the specific race. But if you are doing study limited to India, then it would be the race is basically same, Asian India. So when we try to compare with the different populations, then the race would come in mind, that African American has high risk, or African, the black race has high risk, or Caucasian has less risk of angle closure. Then when we talk about comparing, or we have a mixed race group population, which is not the case at least in India. We should specify, yes. We should. Or we can, in methodology only, we can make it very clear that we had all 100% were Asian Indian to start with. So that would come in table 1 when we talk about the demography. So the cross-section studies identify the prevalence. When we go back and look the same population, we know incidence of cases. So basically, cross-section, what we get, disease, no disease, and you have glaucoma present, not present, then again the same thing, you can look for the risk factors. IOP more, IOP less than 21, in the same in disease and no disease, and you can say that IOP in the disease group is more than 21, the risk is this much. So when you compare prevalence of disease in exposed versus non-exposed, A divided by A plus B versus C divided by C plus D. Not possible for causal relationship. In cross-sectional study, you can say that most of the people with glaucoma have IOP more than 21. That doesn't translate that intraocular pressure is a risk factor as a causal risk and disease association from cross-sectional study. You can only say that 70% people with glaucoma had pressure more than 21, 22, 23, whatever cutoff you use. For blood sugar, if you use fasting, use 120, whatever. But you can only say that blood sugar was high in this many people. But you cannot diagnose and say that intraocular pressure as a cause and effect relationship based on cross-sectional study. Because you don't know. There may be some other factors which are playing part, which you have not established, or you don't know. So cross-sectional studies give you idea, and from then you can frame a question and do a different kind of studies. But you cannot put it down in the paper that I examine 100 people all 80 had IOP more than 21 or 78% glaucoma had pressure more than 21. Hence, intraocular pressure is a risk factor and has cause and effect relationship. That you cannot say. Causal association you cannot from cause and from cross-sectional studies. Case control now is not cross-sectional. Now what you are doing, you are taking two arms. In one arm, you are taking cases. In other arm, you are taking controls. And you match for the all the other factors other than the questions what you are looking for. So basically, if I am looking for glaucoma, and if I then I would define glaucoma in a way which I have to write down in the paper, that intraocular pressure I would not put as a criteria if I have to do both normal open angle glaucoma, because we know that certain percent of people can have glaucoma based with normal pressure also, or else I can put down high tension glaucoma pressure more than 21. The disc and field changes, then I have examined all the 100 and 100 or 200 and 100, whichever way we do. For that complete eye examination is done. Apart from the glaucoma factor, the both groups should have a similar characteristic. That means they should have similar age group, similar gender distribution. I cannot have 100 male in one arm and 100 female in other arm. Then if you are looking glaucoma, then your question, you should know that there is a family history. So you would not put family members in a control group, because that would induce bias. So those factors you have to keep in mind. You match them. There are different ways of matching. We can't go again and go in detail. But one is group matching, where overall you try to match both the group. That is not perfect. Ideal is one-to-one matching. So one control case, one control. So ideally speaking, if I have a 60-year-old male glaucoma patient as number one case, then I should have a 60-year-old male without glaucoma as control. Am I right, sir? And then you finish your two groups. Then you have a disease positive, disease non-positive, non-disease with exposure. So if your IOP, let's say, we are talking about glaucoma and IOP more than 21. So you have glaucoma, pressure more than 21. You have glaucoma with pressure less than 21. You have non-glaucoma, pressure more than 21. You know that certain people can have ocular hypertension, they may not have glaucoma. And you have low, huge normal with pressure less than 21. And then you look at proportion of cases with exposure of risk factor more than 21, with as opposed to control with pressure more than 21. And this is how you find out that what is the risk factor of intraocular pressure, high intraocular pressure, for causing glaucoma. So you begin with the people with disease and compare with people without disease. Case control study design. We define the case. Population from the cases are selected has to be very clear. There are lots of ways. Some people would say that ideally you should not have hospital cases, but that depends upon which questions you are looking for. But control also has to be very clear. It should be matched for the cases. And as I said, that if you have glaucoma, then you cannot take the sibling, because there is a family history. So you have to look which disease you are looking for, whether it is a genetic predisposition or not. Then you don't take controls accordingly. Matching we have discussed. This is how the case control study. Any question in case control study or anything, sir, you want to add? Any question for case control, then we move on to cohort.
Anything, Nathan?
Like, for example, you take diabetic retinopathy. In one eye, you have done cataract. In the other eye, you have not done cataract. It has progressed in this eye. So use that as decision. Use this as a control.
For certain papers, we have used that.
You can use it. That's why I'm asking you.
I think...
What are the bias in, because in, that induced in
both
such
eyes
cases?
Usually behave similarly. So taking one eye as a case and one eye as a control usually would induce some amount of bias, but I'm not sure.
Would it? I don't know if it really induces, because there are some things I wanted to study and I thought, why not use one eye as control?
Actually, I'm scared because I'm walking into a trick question, okay? In general, in statistics, there is a notion that we deal with independent events. So each person or each case that you deal is independent of the other. So, and that is fundamental to all statistical thinking. Now, when you take one eye of one patient and look at the other eye, then the problem comes, are they two really independent phenomena? They are not. But that is a little bit of a too conservative an approach. And my answer to this question is, yes, you can use the other eye as a comparison group. That depends on the research question. Okay? So don't tie yourself in a knot. You have got a freedom to do anything you want, provided you can logically justify.
So I can use.
For like, we wanted to compare the phaco trap versus small incision trap. And we used one eye for phaco trap and one eye for small incision trap, thinking that usually they behave similarly. So what the astigmatic difference or what the IOP difference we get would be purely because of the surgical technique, and we use single surgeon. Therefore, I think for that kind of questions.
That is the interventional.
Yeah.
I mean, they behave independently. The eye, if the result.
If they behave independently.
So you can use ultimately what it means. You can use one eye as control and the other eye as the subject.
No, but not in all.
No. That in that situation, what we are doing is we are matching for everything. Eye also, biology, immunology, everything. The only difference is the two types of intervention.
Yes.
So you can get the pure effect, the difference in intervention, when you use one eye versus the other eye.
Yes.
So it's a very highly matched situation.
So the depends on the research question,
yeah,
whether you can use or you cannot.
I think for majority of the questions, we will not be able to use one eye versus other eye. I think for majority of the questions, using one eye as a case and control,
yes,
would induce bias. For some specific questions,
but you cannot use.
No, it's not like that. But publishing is always difficult, because reviewer will always have that notion that induces bias, and they would invariably have the questions that how can you use one eye as a case and one eye as control. And that is what happened for that paper. It took so long to get published. Because every reviewer, the rejection was always start with the first comment that there is a severe bias, because author used the same patient, one eye for the this and one, so there is a bias. They should have used a different patient. So to publish is this kind of thing is very difficult.
Actually, sir, both types of paper have been published. One using only one eye from patient, one using both eyes independently. Now question arises whether these data will be paired or unpaired when you use both eye on a single patient. But both type of papers has been published, and here comes the question of quality. How much weight you will give the paper where both eyes has been used, and how much weight it is.
See, whatever system we have, a blind review, unblind review, all that, at the end of the day, the name of the author
that's
does count.
I'm saying. How much?
And that's why when you read the article, you have to see the quality, methodology of the article, and then decide whether this is good enough,
yeah,
to use for the your practice.
Yeah.
Second, if you are the first one, nobody has published, then journal, and the question is of reasonable interest, the journal usually is, they tend to relax the criteria. Because all the journals want to publish first. So if your question is interesting and if you are the first one, then you study methodology, some flaws, of course major flaw nobody will allow, but some flaws would get unnoticed, or editor would bypass it. So that those things happen. But at the end of the day, you have to see, read the article for yourself, seeing the methodology.
Actually, I personally believe one eye of one patient should be used in any of the, whether intervention or whether anyway. But I perplexed, even in glaucoma, articles have been published where both eyes have been used from the same patient.
Actually, ideally speaking, yes, one eye. Yeah. But I don't think that we can have the freak's criteria. We can always...
I prefer one eye, I give a clinical example from IMVR surgeon. So VR, when you inject Avastin one eye, it has been showed the some effect comes in other eye also. Okay, so that will confound the results. If you are using it, the amount of drug will be more. The eye which is injected later. So that's why I
think we said it depends on the research question. Okay, for example, we want to know what is the average intraocular pressure in a population. When you keep measuring both the eyes and sum it up and give an average, what happens is each individual provides two readings, right and left. Okay? And some people with one eye will give one reading.
Yes.
Okay, now there is some problem coming back because two eyes tend to have similar pressures. Okay? So that degree of clustering is what statisticians get worried about.
Yes.
Okay. But there are, I remember doing a study on whether steroid alone or decompression surgery for ulnar nerve, which is the best one? I mean, a steroid or surgery, does it help? So in that trial, what we did was randomize the hands. One hand had surgery. Okay, patient got the steroids. That means both the nerves got the steroid. But we try to look at the effect of decompression surgery. Now that's a beautiful design. At the end of it, we found surgery doesn't help at all. Okay. Now matching the patient with the hands is an ideal thing there. So don't get too cluttered by this idea of it independence. Occasionally, as an independent researcher, you should have the ability to rise above it.
Essentially, it boils down to research question. You must be very clear of what is your question based on that.
The next is cohort design. Basically, we select the group with the exposure and followed up to determine the incidence of disease. And if there is a positive association exists between the exposure and disease, incidence in exposure group should be higher than non-incidence. So basically, you have a patient with pressure more than 21 and less than 21, no glaucoma, followed up the patient for years. Now cohort for some of the systemic disease has a better implication because from single exposure you can look for the multiple disease as opposed to glaucoma, because then cost involved is too huge for the benefit of the study. But anyway, basically you have two groups, pressure more than 21, less than 21, otherwise eyes are absolutely normal, systemic factor matched in both the groups, and you follow it up for years. Now depending upon, you know from the previous studies and literature, that how many years it takes for glaucoma to develop from baseline. That ocular hypertension at the end of 5 years, we have chances of developing glaucoma in untreated arm 10%. If you follow it up 15 years, chance of getting blindness, certain percent. So based on that, you decide the number of people and the years of follow-up. And you follow it up. Assessment here is very important. Who is going to examine? Its study will go on for years. People, examiner will keep changing, because if you are doing it, let's say in here, in JJ Hospital, the residents would keep changing. So if there is no quality control, then the results at the end of the 10 years would be useless. So there are lots of factors in the cohort study we have to keep in mind at the beginning and then do the study. Then the second question is the question in mind. If I want to do the cohort study to look for the family history and glaucoma, can you tell me how many years it would require? what we have to have? The first generation, then second generation. The glaucoma starts in the age of 35, 40. So if I have 45-year-old people in the first generation, at the best their kids would be 15 years, 20 years, then we are looking another 30 years. So study would go on for 30 years. During 30 years, how many people would migrate? How the loss of follow-up? So all these things we have to keep in mind before you frame the question and start the study. It's much easier to do the first part. The cohort is all about follow-up. For ocular hypertension, we would require at least 5 years. For blindness, we require at least 20 years. And family history, at least 2, ideally 3 generations. So we are looking at 60, 70 years. So basically, the longitudinal study, comparative observational, in which subjects are grouped by their exposure. Exposed and unexposed for the specific risk factor are followed up for years. The examination criteria has to be very specific and standardized. And then we look for the development of the disease. And what we do? Relative risk or hazard ratio, incidence of disease in exposure divided by incidence of disease in non-exposure, 2-by-2 table. Now, when the blackboard or whiteboard comes with the marker, ask Professor Mudial, he is the best person to teach 2-by-2 table. From right, left, every angle, the way he would teach you 2-by-2 table, nobody else will be able to teach you. But basically, you look for the relative risk, A divided by A plus B, C divided by C plus D. Now, nutshell, selection of sample from the population, measure predictive variable in sample, follow up the population 2 arms and measure the outcome. So some of the famous study, I will give example, Framingham, Nurses Health Study, Physician Health Study. The Framingham Heart Study now has finished 3 generation. And you know number of publication from these studies? 1200 publication. And some of the important outcomes are cigarette smoking found to increase the risk of heart disease, cholesterol level, blood pressure and ECG abnormalities found to increase the risk of heart disease, so on and so forth. So cohort studies are important, but they have several limitations and weakness. Expensive, inefficient if you are studying a rare outcome, need long follow-up, severe attrition in follow-up rate, loss of follow-up. So when you decide the sample size, those all factors has to keep in mind before decide the sample size. Cohort study, any questions before we move on? Dr. Mulyal actually is not very fond of cohort study. In a sense, we are discussing and you said that we can do the cross-sectional study. Any question for cohort study before we move on? Temporal relationship. That is better. But
is it true?
No, the issue is this. In a well-done cohort study, you can deliberately avoid a temporal ambiguity. Okay. Case control study, unless you are fairly careful, it's difficult. Now, you remember the very famous study on smoking and lung cancer. People found that there is a strong association. Now, where is the temporal ambiguity? The temporal ambiguity means this. Is there a confusion? Which came first? Did people with early cancer start smoking? or smokers develop lung cancer. Most intelligent people say there is no temporal ambiguity. So you see, temporal ambiguity is an issue that human beings have to judge. In other words, to convince people, a cohort study usually is much easier. Say, listen, I took a group of people, they were all disease-free to start with. Some were smoking, some were not smoking. I followed them up, see, this is what happened. So generally everybody will agree. But that doesn't mean case controls are bad. Okay?
So want to determine the prevalence, we have to do cross-sectional. Association of disease and several exposure, case control. Association of exposure and several disease, cohort design. This is the basic outline. The last is RCT. I think we have some specific RCT tomorrow, na?
Yeah.
Because RCT is too long to cover in 5-7 minutes, and we can stop it here.
Also, you have to stop it here because Nayak has to. We will, as we go along, we will tell you all the details, and you will gather more information. Suddenly, if you start talking about RCT design and all, it becomes very confusing. So we'll take you through stages. So right now, the study design she has given you is for how to do case control studies, cohort studies, etc., etc. RCTs comes late. That is because RCTs give you the highest possible correct answer to a given problem. So they are more complicated to design and carry out also.
Thank you, Rajul. Can I ask Dr. Santan Gopal to give the memento to Dr. Rajul Parikh?